Thank you very much, Professor Carà. And I'd like to thank the Accademia dei Lincei for this nice invitation. And I'd like to say good morning to everyone. So I have some slides that I'm going to share now. And talking about the challenges for the plastics in the circular economy. I hope you are seeing my slides. So today we are talking about this trend that is unavoidable. The circular economy is something that is already happening, actually, and we are going towards that goal that has been defined by several institutions. And so here, the role of the plastics in this is crucial because is under the eyes of everyone. So I'd like to start with the vision of the European Union in the circular economy connected to the plastics. And so we have understood that our society is consuming resources to an unsustainable extent. And so we need to do something. And the European community actually has already depicted a strategy for the plastics. And they are asking the plastic producers to give this contribution, their contribution. So we need to be smart, we need to be innovative, we need to be sustainable, because we need to design and produce plastic materials that respect fully the needs of the society. And basically we need to apply the keywords for the circular economy: reuse, repair, reduce, and recycling, which is also very important. So European Union has also defined a very specific targets for this. And so we have by 2030, so in one decade, basically the need to have all the plastic packaging that is placed in Europe, which must be either reusable or can be recycled. And we also have heard already that more than 50% of the plastic waste generated in Europe must be recycled. And this is something that we need to pursue, including the investments in sorting and recycling capacity that has to be increased at least four times in this decade since the situation in 2015. So the plastic contribution, why the plastic has had such much success, and what is the contribution to the circular economy? First of all, we need to remind that the CO2 emitted per capita in Europe is basically due to other things than the plastic packaging. If we think that the two-thirds of the CO2 emitted is due to the food and energy, and the rest basically due to transportation, we can see that the plastic packaging has only a tiny contribution to the CO2 emitted so per capita. And this is clearly seen also in comparing the use of the plastic material with respect to other materials in packaging. So for instance, we have a very strong reduction of the weight of the material that we are transporting by using plastics with respect to alternative products. And this means that also the energy required to transport the goods is much lower in case of use of plastic. It would be much higher if we use alternative materials. So for instance, if we see the weight that we have to transport to move food or other goods by using plastics, this is remarkably lower than the weight that we would have by using alternative materials. And so this means that we need to make more trips. This means that we need to use more energy to transport this weight. And this means that we would have more CO2 if we don't use plastics. That's why plastic has had such an introduction in the plastic in the packaging. But the other big reason is the fact that with plastics, we are able to reduce the food loss. And this is a paramount importance in the use of the food for the worldwide population. So if we see what is the decrease of loss of food in various cases, so you can see by using plastic packaging, you can see that we have lost much less edible food than what was in the past by using other materials. And this is crucial for, let's say, one of the sustainable goals of the United States nations, that is the fight to the hunger, as we'll see. And so then innovation has been also, let's say, playing a role really important in the food packaging, because by using an innovative design of the packaging, of the film, actually we are able to reduce the amount of material that is required to conserve that food and to transport it. And basically this meant to do more with less material. And that's why the industry has used the innovation capability to design these multi-layer films. We have only 15 microns multi-layer film today that is able to preserve the food, because there are layers that are responsible for putting a barrier to the oxygen transmission, other layers that are contributing to the water transmission, so that we can preserve the food in a very efficient way by using a less amount of material. But we'll see this multi-layers film, mixed plastics, then makes more difficult the recycling of this material at the end of the life. And so this is, let's say, the concept of preserving food. If we compare the CO2 that is lost in case of food loss with respect to the CO2 used to produce the material that is used for the packaging, you can realize immediately that the CO2 emission is much higher in case of the loss of food with respect to the CO2 emitted for the plastic packaging that prevented that loss. And so there is an enormous advantage in using this plastic packaging in terms of climate change as well. And another important innovation is the reduction of the material. Reduction of the material means that we can use less and less material by improving the quality of the material. And so we have a weight reduction in several items that are used to package food. And this goes towards another important direction, that is the reduction of the use of material. And you can see that sometimes the weight reduction can be really remarkable. But then the use of the plastic material has given other benefits towards the reduction of the CO2. Let's think to the insulation of our buildings, of our houses. We can see that by using the new materials that have been developed, we can save a lot of energy. So that means saving of gas, oil, or other energies, which means at the end save CO2 emitted to heat up our houses. And this was also another important contribution of the plastic material. Then we don't forget the contribution to the automotive industry. We can see today that we have in every car on average more than 150 kilograms of plastic per each car. And actually, if you make the life cycle analysis of the items here, you can see really a benefit as compared to the previous material. 40 years ago, we had bumpers in metal. And then starting with the Fiat Ritmo and many other cars, today every car has a bumper made in polypropylene. And this made a saving in the energy required to move all the cars. Another important aspect is the water preservation, because the pipe made in plastic actually have given a contribution to the reduction of the weight of the material that we need to make to produce pipes. And also the long lasting of this piping ensures, let's say, the water not losses, so water preservation. And this made a saving in terms of economy, in terms of water usage in buildings and in our aqueducts. So then with all these advantages, we do have a problem today. And this is clearly the problem of the plastic waste. So what to do with the plastic waste? Unfortunately, we have seen that plastic is present in the environment, is thrown away. We have marine littering. All the oceans have plastic wastes going around. And this is clearly something that is unacceptable for our society and for all of us, basically. And so we have seen how big is the problem of the marine littering. All around the world, we have plastics in the ocean. And we have seen already that the source of this littering is coming from the ground, is coming from the human behaviors, and it's also due to the lack of infrastructure that we have in many countries. And so we have so many million tons of plastics that every year are thrown through the river via the ocean. Most of them are in the Asian, but the key factor is due to the rivers. The rivers are basically moving the mismanaged plastic waste from the cities, from where the population lives, towards the sea. And so this is really a global problem that we need to fix somehow. We cannot accept this kind of pollution. And so there are several legislations that have been already introduced, and we can expect even more in the future. One of those legislations are the ones that have been issued by the European Union. And actually we are in the front line, probably in the world, in terms of sustainability and defining policies towards the sustainability. And there is clearly the need to prevent the plastic waste going into the environment, to collect it, and to develop a recycling system. And we need to establish this system, or this management system, to prevent the pollution, in particular in the emerging economies, like we have seen for the marine littering. And so European community is actually promoting a lot of international forums, international actions that will try to fix the problem of the end of the plastic waste. Another important policy that has been introduced is the so-called single-use plastic directive, in which every state member in Europe has to transform into a law enforcement. And this directive actually has identified some specific use of plastics, single use, that you can see here. So we go from the sticks, the straws, the cutlery, the plates, all this stuff that have clearly a single use, and then they are thrown away. And so we have to limit this kind of use, and thus contributing to reduce the amount of plastic that eventually has to be treated later on. Other important pieces are given also to the plastic packaging type of applications. For instance, there is the directive to keep the caps and lids attached to the container after the intended use. And this would help to reduce the dispersion of plastic items in the collection system, hopefully, but also in the environment. And there are also specific targets for the PET beverage bottles, in which we need, or let's say the directive asks for targets of including recycled material in the plastic bottles, and these are by 2030 at least 30% of the recycled plastics. Now, here as plastic producers, we have taken a strong commitment to contribute to this. So to these goals and to this problem. So first of all, we have a voluntary commitment in preventing the leakage of plastics, the pellets, all the items that are produced. They don't go to the environment. So we need to prevent the pellet loss. We need to accelerate the resource efficiency so that we can increase the circularity. We need to accelerate innovation as well. And this is a clear commitment. And we need to use the concept of the reuse, but also the recycling for plastic packaging. And plastic is a key word for the circular economy, definitely. We have set up also an alliance, a global alliance called Alliance to End Plastic Waste, in which we have put together plastic producers, brand owners, waste management companies, the whole chain of the plastic producers until the management of the wastes in order to fix, or let's say, in order to improve the situation of the plastic loss in the environment. We have set up investments, this alliance for billion of dollars in these 5 years. And basically we are working on four work streams. This is the strategy. Definitely we need to build infrastructure. We cannot have waste unmanaged. The collection system, the sorting system, separation system is crucial to avoid the plastic waste in the environment. We need to have innovation. We need to develop technologies. We have talked about the chemical recycling. Still, we need to develop those technologies to improve the recycling as complementary to the mechanical recycling we have. But we need also to innovate in the plastic design, in the material design, in the packaging design, in order to have more recyclable packaging down the road. We need to educate people. Without education, we cannot solve a problem. If people continue to throw away the plastic material, then this problem won't be solved, even if we have infrastructure and innovation. And of course, we need to clean up what has been wasted in the environment until today. And you can see big names in this alliance. We have plastic producers, we have brand owners like Procter & Gamble, and we have waste management companies like Suez, like Veolia, and those kind of folks. Now, we have talked about recycling. So mechanical recycling is already a reality in Europe, not yet fully developed, but still much more developed than other countries. In US, for instance, we have only 9% of the plastic material recycled, which is much lower than the figures we have in Europe. But the chemical recycling is what is needed to increase the recycling of plastic materials. Without that, we won't be able to get the target that the European community and the society actually asks us to solve the problem. And chemical recycling would mean, we have seen, to transform the plastic waste into chemicals, normally shorter molecules, either monomers or new feedstocks for the polymer production, for the plastic productions, or chemicals that can be used in the chemical industry chain. And this is essential to increase the recycling, as I was mentioning. Today, this is the situation in Europe. We have a well-established system. We have about 32% of mechanical recycling already in place for the plastics, but we still need to have a lot of energy recovery, and we have still a landfill. In a foreseeable future in which the landfill is not anymore allowed, then the increase of the mechanical recycling and the introduction of chemical recycling would be, let's say, crucial for the increase of the circularity. And of course, we will still have very likely the thermal valorization of the of what is the residual. We would recover, of course, the energy, but all the rest would recover the mass, the material, which is also so important. And so at the end, what are crucial to get the objectives of the circular economy? These are the education, definitely. This is the technology, in addition to what is the infrastructure. So we need to achieve the separate collection, 100% to have the end of waste plastics. And this is a contribution that everyone can give, and everyone is indispensable to get those objectives, including, of course, the education, because we need to have a civic education to get those targets. Let me conclude with, let's say, a remind of what is the role of the plastics within the sustainable development goals developed by the United Nations. So the role of plastics, actually, we have a direct influence of some of them. I'd like to remember the no hunger objective. We need the good health, so the preservation of the human health, the medical application of the plastics, that is so important to get that goal. And then the clean water. We have talked about the loss of water and the use of the plastics in the pipe applications. This is crucial to get the goal number six. And then the clean energy as well, the innovation and the infrastructure. Plastic can play a substantial role. And then our cities and communities will need to be more sustainable. And the plastics we have seen have an important role on that. And then finally, in the responsibility, in the responsible consumption of the energy. So in conclusion, plastic are so important for our life, for our economy, for the quality of the life of everyone. And plastics, by using innovation, by using what I was mentioning before, education, investments, and technology will help the achievement of the sustainable goals of the United Nations. Thank you very much for your attention.